Ladies and gentlemen, we will start this debate with our guests coming from different political parties about the European elections, as we have committed to organize a series of debates about this important issues. So first, I would like to give the floor to Mr. Markey for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, President. I'm delighted to be here today as somebody who's a former member of a local authority and indeed a regional authority. It's very close to my heart. I spent 13 years on a local authority and 5 years on a regional assembly. So I really, really do appreciate being here. And as somebody who was formerly a chair of a leader company and worked long, I think 8 years in a leader company and on rural development in general, I think this is such an important issue. For me, there's about five things that ultimately matter if we're going to talk about developing rural areas in Europe into the future. The first, from my perspective, is agriculture is the cornerstone of our rural economies. And we have to ensure into the future that agriculture is, if you like, developed under the new CAP, that we ensure that agriculture, if you like, is evolves and develops into the future. From a farming perspective, generational renewal is a key part of that. And I believe that access to finance for young farmers to allow them redevelop the farms and ensure that they're innovative into the future is important. If you look at the difference between agriculture and other sectors, you find that with agriculture, people give longer hours and are constantly, if you like, working harder than their counterparts. We have to give young people in agriculture an opportunity that ensures that their future is as good as their peers in other areas. Beside that, we need to ensure that the new opportunities that rural economies have are developed, particularly the area of renewable energies. Where I come from in Ireland, the western half of our country is perhaps underdeveloped relative to the urban areas close to Dublin. And I'm a big believer that there's the potential to balance up the economies of rural areas by investing in the like of renewable energies, be it offshore wind, be it onshore wind. These type of scenarios are key towards the future of generating economic development in rural areas. Next to that, I think it's critical that we focus on our town centres. Our rural regional town centres are in decline in a lot of parts of Europe, particularly in the country I come from, in Ireland, and how we invest in our town centres to create a new, if you like, a new experience, be it a retail experience, a social experience, and develop the nighttime economy in our rural towns and villages. That is critical. One part of developing that is the idea of remote working. In Ireland, we've put a big focus on remote working in more recent years, and in conjunction with that, in the development of broadband. And to give people the opportunities to remain in their own communities, and if you like, play for the local sports team, if you like, buy their coffee in the local shop, and the multiplier that has in the local economy is critical. So I think it's critical that we ensure that those town centres develop and that the potential to work remotely, be it from the home or in a hub in their local town or village, is critical to sustaining rural communities. Beyond that, I think we have to look at the broader infrastructure piece. If you like, in many of our rural areas, rail connections, transport infrastructure is limited, and we need to ensure that broader infrastructure improves as we go forward. From, like, if you consider in many rural areas that the connectivity, when you're trying to bring inward investment, the connectivity to those rural areas is often less than what it should be. Many times we look, where I live close to Dublin, it can be difficult to attract inward investment to places, more remote locations, because of transport connectivity, because of a shortage of skills. And we have to ensure that those skills, that brain drain, is stopped by ensuring those opportunities are available through, if you like, remote working in particular, the delivery of broadband as well, to ensure that those opportunities are there. Ultimately, we have to see that our rural areas offer people the same opportunities as urban areas do. And that's what we failed to do, if you like, over the last number of years. I think we need to invest in the agricultural end to ensure that the CAP, the future CAP, embraces new opportunities. We have to look at the other opportunities that are out there in terms of renewable energies, the green transition, sustainability around protecting our nature and biodiversity. There's numerous opportunities in those areas, and how we develop them into the future is critical. But the most important thing is that we ensure that we invest in infrastructure that allows people access and live in those areas in a similar way to what we can in urban areas. So from my perspective going forward, CAP and regional investment in terms of infrastructure are critical towards the future of, if you like, the development of our regional areas. And happy to take questions later on. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your intervention. Tenho agora o gosto e o prazer de dar a palavra à minha conterrânea, Isabel Carvalhais, de Portugal. Tem a palavra por 5 minutos.
Muito obrigada. Eu começo por saudar o Sr. Presidente do Comitê das Regiões, estimado Vasco Cordeiro, e todos os caros membros do Comitê das Regiões, naturalmente todos os que me acompanham também aqui nesta parte. Eu gostaria de agradecer muito ao Comitê das Regiões e, em particular, ao PES, pelo amável convite que me permite estar hoje aqui. É sempre uma honra e é sempre um prazer enorme poder debater as oportunidades e os desafios do mundo rural. E este é um debate que não poderia ser mais oportuno, porque esta é a altura de refletir em que linhas queremos, afinal, traçar o próximo quadro comunitário de apoio, cujas propostas irão começar a surgir em meados de 2025, ou seja, amanhã, porque o tempo corre. E falamos de um quadro que não pode, de modo algum, passar ao largo das zonas rurais como uma das suas grandes prioridades. Porque a implementação do Pilar Europeu dos Direitos Sociais para uma sociedade europeia mais justa, mais equitativa, não se concretiza sem a garantia de que os cidadãos rurais beneficiam de condições equitativas a qualquer outro cidadão da União Europeia para atingir os seus objetivos profissionais, pessoais e sociais. A comunicação da Comissão Europeia sobre a visão a longo prazo foi uma ferramenta muito útil no seu tempo, em particular para salientar à sociedade o quão urgente é a ação no presente e no futuro nas áreas rurais, mas, convenhamos, foi lançada tardiamente, numa fase já avançada da programação do novo quadro financeiro e dos seus principais instrumentos, nomeadamente ligados à política de coesão e à política agrícola e desenvolvimento rural. Um erro que tem de ser evitado no futuro. Olhando agora para a frente, como é que podemos garantir então que não deixamos ninguém para trás? Como é que evitamos o sentimento de abandono, de exclusão dos espaços da decisão política e da consequente desafeição à própria democracia no espaço rural? As respostas são complexas, têm necessariamente de ser multidisciplinares e de contar com alguma criatividade. Mas por vezes não é preciso inventar a roda, mas sim explorar plenamente o potencial dos instrumentos e políticas já existentes, e isso só por si pode ser inovador. Por exemplo, garantir uma melhor articulação entre todas as políticas e fundos europeus, incluindo os de gestão direta, bem como os nacionais, através de uma cultura de simplificação administrativa. Isto só por si seria inovador, porque a verdade é que, embora todos saibamos o quão importante é esta articulação, na prática ela não se concretiza e conta com muitas dificuldades. Foi por isso que propusemos, no relatório do Parlamento Europeu, a necessidade de remover obstáculos persistentes à abordagem multifundos. Como se podem remover esses obstáculos? Por exemplo, através do alargamento da abordagem fundo principal às intervenções cofinanciadas por mais de um fundo de gestão partilhado, através da possibilidade de transferir recursos financeiros entre todos os fundos de gestão partilhada, sempre que o objetivo seja sustentar estratégias territoriais rurais, Por exemplo, também através de uma nova cultura administrativa de simplificação, não é de facilitismo, mas de simplificação, a começar desde logo em Bruxelas. Uma segunda dimensão que muito rapidamente gostaria de destacar diz respeito à necessidade de reconhecer a dimensão rural como uma abordagem política exigente e integrada. O desenvolvimento do espaço rural implica uma visão interdisciplinar, como eu dizia, e de facto não é possível concretizá-lo sem uma visão integrada de todos os aspectos que afetam esse desenvolvimento. Sejam os transportes, a mobilidade, as energias renováveis, a saúde, a educação, os serviços sociais, a cultura e o lazer, a agricultura, a justiça, a igualdade de género, a proteção da biodiversidade, etc. Portanto, é fundamental olhar, sim, para o desenvolvimento rural, para além das chamadas políticas tradicionais de desenvolvimento rural e regional, ou seja, a PAC e a política de coesão, e começar a pensar o rural de uma forma mais integrada e horizontal. A Comissão Europeia publicou recentemente um relatório sobre o progresso da visão a longo prazo. Eu não vou, obviamente, falar sobre isto, mas há uma frase lapidar que, no fundo, repete tudo aquilo que temos andado a dizer há muito tempo, que é necessário ação contínua, políticas que atravessem os períodos de programação e a todos os níveis de programação. Ora, só falta concretizar isto mesmo que a Comissão nos diz. De qualquer forma, para terminar mesmo, e já excedi-me no meu tempo, este é o momento. É o momento de enviar uma mensagem muito clara e inequívoca às zonas rurais de toda a Europa, de que nos preocupamos com as suas comunidades, com os seus homens e as suas mulheres, com os seus jovens e com os seus idosos, com todos os seus habitantes, com todos os que aí laboram, e reconhecer que a melhor forma de o demonstrar não é só dizê-lo e proclamá-lo, é fazê-lo. Muito obrigado.
Muito obrigado, Isabel. Now it's my pleasure to give the floor to Mrs. Ciolos, member of the European Parliament. You have the floor, sir, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chair. So I'm here on behalf of my political group, which is Renew Europe. But I cannot avoid also my past as former European Commissioner for Agriculture and Rural Development. And I would start with some provocative statement. We talk about rural areas in Europe. We have to recognize that we don't have a real EU rural development policy. We have European instruments, financial instruments. Use it in a, as much as possible, coherent way for a local and regional development. And we used to see rural development more connected to agriculture, which is normal in a certain way, or which was normal, let's say, because the main activity in economic activity in rural area was or is still in some regions agriculture, farming. But I think this is also a trap for rural areas. And I remember when I was commissioner, the institutional fight between agriculture, rural development department and regional department. And I think this is in a disadvantage of some rural areas who face, of course, economic problem and the problem mentioned by my colleague from EPP on generational renewable farming in some rural areas remain. But for me, rural areas in Europe are now more complex than simply agriculture. We cannot disconnect rural areas from farming, from environment, from management of natural resources. But we have to recognize that if we want to have a coherent approach on our European rural areas, we should recognize, first of all, diversity of these regions, but the need of a common vision on what we intend to do with these areas. Do we want to isolate these areas from the urban development, fast and accelerated urban development? Do we want to think our interconnectivity in Europe only among big metropolis, which is normal and we need this, but how we will integrate rural areas in this development approach. So for this, and I would like to thank to my colleague Isabel for the report she presented in the parliament, which is, I think, a good starting point to have this kind of discussions, because we need to see in a pragmatic way which are the financial resources for our European rural areas and how we share responsibility between European level and European financial instruments, national level and regional level, taking into account the fact that some regions are more financial power than others, some regions are more interested on rural development, some others more on urban development, and how to put this into coherence. So I think at EU level, trying to avoid this game between DG Agri and DG Regio and other directorate generals, we have to find a way for more coherence and easiest common instruments. For me, leader approach, it's a very efficient one, and he proved efficiency in several areas, and we used to enlarge this for all areas, not only rural, so for this connection rural-urban, more integrated territorial investments, I think, should be also better used in the future, and using not only European financing and public financing, but integrating more also private financing. Because in a lot of areas, when we talk about economic development, this means also to be able to attract private finance. And for this, we have to see, talking about this integrated territorial investment and development, connectivity and infrastructure, transport infrastructure, mobility, but also digital infrastructure, because without digitalization, doesn't matter whether we have or not transport connectivity. So we have to go together with all of this. And also how to ensure the public services, health, education, social services, recognizing that we have poor regions in rural area in Europe. And poverty is not only for the others, but it's also for some regions in Europe, and we have to recognize this. And sometimes this poverty is exactly because this lack of connection. So I will stop here, saying also that we have to manage the migration within rural areas and urban areas, and I can see in my country, in Romania, this migration from the both sides, which is, I think, a good thing. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now the floor goes to our member Lorenzo Galigani. On behalf of ECR, you have the floor for 5 minutes.
Grazie mille, Presidente. Grazie ai colleghi che mi hanno preceduto. Io vi ringrazio per avermi dato l'opportunità di intervenire qui oggi. Sono molto lieto di prendere la parola sul tema del futuro delle aree rurali, che come italiano e come toscano mi sta moltissimo a cuore. L'abbiamo sentito ripetere più volte al Comitato delle Regioni. Le nostre zone rurali sono in declino. I politici di Bruxelles devono sviluppare una maggiore intelligenza rurale e una maggiore consapevolezza sui territori. Noi dobbiamo sviluppare una maggiore intelligenza rurale e una maggiore consapevolezza dei territori. I cittadini delle aree rurali si sentono completamente scollegati dal processo politico e decisionale di Bruxelles. Molti non capiscono nemmeno cosa viene chiesto loro, soprattutto quando si tratta di alcune delle politiche più ideologiche di questo mandato, come il divieto di vendita delle auto con motore a combustione a partire dal 2035. Per entrare nello specifico. Si tratta di una decisione molto radicale, che avrà un impatto grave e devastante su molti dei nostri cittadini, soprattutto quelli delle zone rurali, che dipendono in larga misura dalle automobili per spostarsi e per lavorare. Non solo stiamo parlando di comprendere migliaia di posti di lavoro del settore, di comprimere migliaia di posti di lavoro nel settore automobilistico, ma si tratta anche di una decisione politica che avrà ripercussioni sul potere d'acquisto dei nostri cittadini. Molti non potranno permettersi i veicoli elettrici. Molti esperti già parlano della motorizzazione elettrica di massa come di una bolla elettrica. E ancora, come ci aspettiamo che le autorità periferiche abbiano le capacità economiche e tecniche di installare sufficienti sistemi di ricarica? È un errore deplorevole, servirà solo a rendere felici i nostri concorrenti cinesi, che tra l'altro governano anche le filiere di approvvigionamento delle materie prime. Eppure parliamo del senso di isolamento e di lontananza delle nostre aree rurali, aggravato dal declino economico e dalla mancanza di opportunità di lavoro locali. Perché l'Unione Europea e la sua macchina politica usano costantemente i divieti invece degli incentivi per costruire le nostre economie e le nostre capacità industriali e la nostra autonomia strategica? Secondo un recente sondaggio, il divieto dell'UE 2035 è di fatto la misura protezionistica del clima meno popolare nei paesi come Germania, Francia e Polonia, anche fra gli elettori dei partiti di centro-sinistra. Le aree rurali saranno ancora una volta lasciate indietro se continuiamo su questa strada. Per questo ribadiamo sempre che la neutralità tecnologica deve essere il principio guida per la fondazione di politiche valide. Lasciamo che siano gli Stati membri a decidere quale sia il percorso più conveniente per raggiungere lo zero netto. Quando si è trattato di transizione verde, per troppo tempo i responsabili politici hanno creduto che il fine giustificasse i mezzi, il che rappresenta di fatto un approccio dall'alto verso il basso. In futuro dovranno ammettere che il viaggio è importante quanto la destinazione. Il raggiungimento della transizione verde dovrebbe dare potere alle regioni, creando posto di lavori, portando investimenti e riportando così la forza lavoro nelle campagne per mitigare la fuga dei cervelli e il lento invecchiamento delle popolazioni. Ma non è mai stato così. Vediamo giovani disillusi, spesso costretti a lasciare la loro città natale in mancanza di opportunità di lavoro, mentre le città continuano a soffrire di sovraffollamento, inquinamento e prezzi inaccessibili. Vediamo i segnali di una crescente malcontento da parte degli agricoltori, li abbiamo visti anche nei giorni addietro, esattamente qui davanti ai nostri edifici dove si esercita il governo continentale. Siamo sinceri, la transizione verde ha portato regolamenti soffocanti per i nostri agricoltori e minaccia di uccidere le industrie, causando le fabbriche abbandonate come pietre tombali sparse nel paesaggio europeo. Queste sono le reali preoccupazioni degli abitanti delle aree rurali, che spesso sentono che la loro voce non viene ascoltata quando si tratta di questi temi. Non dimentichiamo che l'agricoltura è la pietra miliare dell'Europa e che gli agricoltori europei sono parte della soluzione, sono i primi ecologisti, non sono un problema. 2024 sarà l'occasione per voltare pagina e adottare un nuovo approccio. I responsabili politici devono smettere di progettare le politiche e i programmi dell'Unione Europea con un approccio centralizzato uguale per tutti, dato che tale approccio centralizzato sarà sempre inefficace per affrontare le esigenze territoriali specifiche e non avrà la necessaria titolarità e la necessaria autorevolezza per realizzare investimenti a lungo termine in ogni regione, in particolare nelle zone rurali, in particolare nelle zone rurali montane e collinari, di cui spesso abbiamo parlato in questa sede. In conclusione, le valutazioni di impatto territoriale devono diventare una chiave di volta del processo decisionale europeo. I politici devono essere complessivamente più pragmatici, a partire da noi stessi dobbiamo essere complessivamente più pragmatici e offrire soluzioni basate sui risultati che diano priorità alla prosperità economica e sociale del continente. La transizione deve essere anche una transizione socialmente ed economicamente sostenibile, perché i cittadini devono venire prima di tutto. A partire dal 2024 le politiche dovranno essere molto più incentrate sui cittadini, abbandonando un approccio ideologico. Questo è l'unico modo per far sentire la voce delle popolazioni rurali e per evitare che l'UE diventi un soggetto percepito come ideologico e ostile dalle popolazioni locali. Grazie.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Member Galigani. Now I would like to give the floor to MEP Lydie Massard. Thank you for being with us. You have the floor for 5 minutes on behalf of the European Free Alliance. You have the floor, ma'am.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je vais parler en français.
Très bien.
Bonjour à toutes et à tous et je vous remercie pour votre invitation. Alors d'abord, je voudrais dire que derrière le terme générique de ruralité, il se cache des hommes, des femmes et des centaines de sociétés locales en Union européenne qui sont caractérisées par leurs paysages variés, leur culture locale et parfois même par des langues minoritaires qui leur sont propres. L'Union européenne a investi la question de la ruralité, reconnaissant que les régions sont le cœur de l'Europe. Cependant, les habitants des zones rurales se sentent la plupart du temps marginalisés. Des services publics qui se font rares, des transports inadaptés, des agriculteurs, véritables piliers de la ruralité, qui se trouvent toujours moins nombreux. Alors, la vitalité des zones rurales repose d'abord sur son agriculture, sur ses agriculteurs et sur ses agricultrices. Cependant, nous sommes confrontés à un défi majeur, la transmission des fermes. Parce que pour assurer notre souveraineté et notre sécurité alimentaire, il nous faudra des fermes, il nous en faudra beaucoup et il nous en faudra partout. Le résultat aujourd'hui, c'est que 3 fermes sur 5 optent pour l'agrandissement plutôt que pour la reprise de nouvelles fermes. Il faut changer notre PAC, le premier pilier, à commencer par le premier pilier, où l'argent doit revenir à des politiques qui reviennent à l'actif sur les fermes. Et puis surtout, le second pilier de la PAC, il faut régionaliser notre PAC. Les régions doivent avoir plus de pouvoir pour adapter des politiques agricoles aux besoins spécifiques de leur territoire, reconnaissant ainsi la diversité des pratiques agricoles et des environnements naturels au sein de l'Europe. Il faut reconnaître le rôle crucial de l'agriculture et de la sécurité alimentaire, de la souveraineté alimentaire, en introduisant la notion d'exception alimentaire dans les règles du marché public de l'Union européenne. Il faut permettre aux collectivités locales d'inclure une clause locale dans leurs achats alimentaires pour garantir ainsi une meilleure rémunération des agriculteurs et pour garantir une meilleure alimentation des Européens et des Européennes. Le développement des zones rurales est un problème croissant, le dépeuplement, pardon, des zones rurales est un problème croissant qui menace aujourd'hui la vitalité des régions. Il est crucial de maintenir et de renforcer des services publics essentiels tels que la santé, l'éducation et les transports. Quel médecin, quel ingénieur, quelle entreprise viendra s'installer dans un territoire sans transport efficace et sans école pour y scolariser ses enfants? Les investissements européens doivent se concentrer sur ces services pour garantir un accès équitable aux soins de santé, à l'éducation de qualité, à des infrastructures de transport en commun et du quotidien efficace dans toutes les régions. Le rôle des services publics est important dans l'attraction des talents pour faire venir des entreprises innovantes. En garantissant un haut niveau de services publics, nous pouvons créer un environnement propice à l'installation d'entreprises, à l'innovation et à la création d'emplois locaux. Pour ce faire, un véritable couple Union européenne-région doit exister. Un couple qui facilite l'émergence de projets adaptés, un couple qui facilite le montage des dossiers administratifs. Les zones rurales sont des territoires d'innovation et de diversification économique. Et pour en rassurer leur dynamisme, il est crucial de soutenir les initiatives qui encouragent la création d'emplois et de la croissance économique dans ces régions. L'Union européenne doit investir dans la transition verte, dans le numérique, en mettant en place des programmes spécifiques qui favorisent l'adoption de politiques agricoles durables, le développement des énergies renouvelables et l'accès aux technologies numériques. En utilisant les ressources naturelles des territoires, l'eau, le vent, l'ensoleillement, la mer, nous pouvons stimuler l'innovation. Nous pouvons créer de nouveaux débouchés économiques et renforcer la résilience des communautés rurales face aux défis du XXIe siècle. Je suis triste de voir une entreprise qui fabrique des panneaux solaires dans ma région fermée aujourd'hui même, faute d'une Union européenne qui ne la protège pas suffisamment contre la concurrence chinoise. Je suis triste que les choix des États de l'Union européenne freine le développement des hydroliennes en mer, alors que ma région et ses côtes s'y prêtent énormément. Je conclurai en disant que l'Alliance européenne, nous reconnaissons et nous saluons le travail du Comité des régions. Cependant, nous appelons à une évolution de ces instances vers un rôle décisionnel au sein de l'Union européenne. Nous aspirons à voir les régions dotées de pouvoirs réels et autonomes pour définir leurs politiques régionales, car elles sont les mieux placées pour comprendre les réalités et les besoins de leur territoire. Notre vision pour l'avenir de la ruralité européenne, c'est celle de régions fortes, autonomes, décisionnaires, dirigées par des décideurs et décideuses politiques, experts, capables de s'adapter, de s'entraîner de coopérer pour garantir un développement durable et inclusif des territoires. Je vous remercie.
Thank you. Now the floor goes to Member Ratilainen. You have 5 minutes.
Thank you, President, and dear friends. When we talk about the future of rural areas, we must first of all stand firmly behind a policy agenda that focuses on living and working in these areas. During the pandemic a few years ago, we could observe people moving out of urban areas and cities. Improved internet connection allows them more teleworking, and housing is more affordable outside big cities. Eventually, solutions sometimes are quite concrete, but to see the daylight, those often require European policies behind them. The question, I think, really is, should we keep on the road of improving the quality of life in small towns and villages, finding ways to provide services and infrastructure that people really need? And perhaps we should not always perceive that these regions and villages need more people. Perhaps we should turn the attention on how the people would need these regions and villages more. We want to propose a holistic approach to sustainable rural development that really integrates environmental, social, and economic considerations while promoting resilience and inclusivity. What we need to is to invest in social services, healthcare, and education to ensure equitable access for rural residents. Through holistic investments, we address disparities in rural-urban services and opportunities. And what I want to give a special attention to today is the situation of young people and older people in rural areas. There are quite encouraging examples of smaller towns that attract especially young families by offering them housing opportunities, childcare services, schools, and of course the necessary infrastructure allowing teleworking. There are also quite many towns with special focus on the elder population, also with special needs like dementia. It is worth to explore these pilot projects and to really see to what extent they are replicable throughout Europe. Ways to turn the limelight from the needs of rural areas to the needs of the people in rural areas who would like to reside in rural areas in future. But it is also not sustainable to only focus on attracting people. We want to need to keep them in rural areas as well. I have had the opportunity to get to know many young people who have moved to big cities from rural areas. Opportunities for education and employment has already been mentioned many times, and I fully agree with these perspectives. But these young people often have the same story, another story. What many young people say is that they were forced to leave because they suffered for narrow and illiberal views that would not allow them to be themselves and express themselves. It is an especially pressing issue for the youth who belong in minorities. They stand out in their home villages and not in the way that would bring them well-being and feeling of acceptance. This is something that is harmful both for the youth and for the rural areas. I think we should be quite worried of the fact that far-right is quite attractive in many European countries among population in rural areas. To address European solutions, but local European decision makers also, we should cherish liberal values and diversity in our communities and show example that our communities is a good place to live in all youth. Competitiveness and strong economic performance of communities, as well as investments and innovations, define, of course, the fate and vigor of any community. All good practices and development need to be funded. Connections to urban areas will remain relevant in future. We need to find innovative ways to organize and finance transport in a way that is also contributes to achieve climate neutrality. Rural areas can also really play an active role in energy transition and attract green investments. Farmers are becoming more and more producers of renewable energy, bioenergy, solar energy, and new innovations. Also, small and medium-sized towns are establishing renewable energy communities, which allows the local population to share ownership and to contribute themselves to reduce CO2 emissions. European funding for rural areas is mainly provided through the second pillar of the Common Agricultural Policy, but it is particularly the leader program that supports such local initiatives. Therefore, a crucial question remains: to what extent development of rural areas can really benefit from EU structural funds? We need to prioritize green infrastructure projects and foster diverse economic activities in rural areas. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now we have interventions from the floor, and I would like to give the floor to Member Piotr Calbetti. You have the floor for 1 minute.
Dziękuję bardzo. Panie Przewodniczący, Szanowni Państwo, w imieniu grupy EPL chciałbym zwrócić uwagę, że nasza tożsamość polityczna czerpie ze źródeł naszej europejskiej wsi, ale wieś to nie tylko, dlatego że wieś to nie tylko źródło naszego bezpieczeństwa żywnościowego, ale również naszej tożsamości kulturowej. I dlatego ze wszechmiar trzeba o to dbać. Zbliżają się wybory do parlamentu. Chciałbym jedynie zaapelować do nas wszystkich, członków Komitetu Regionu, abyśmy poszli na wieś europejską, poprosili o włączenie się wszystkich mieszkańców do głosowania, bo z tym jest duży problem, i aby wybrali ludzi, którzy rozumieją rolników, rozumieją obszary wiejskie, i stanowienia na było takie prawo i zmiana takiego wspólnej polityki rolnej w przyszłości, aby nie dochodziło do strajków i konfliktów, których dzisiaj jesteśmy świadkami. No i tak naprawdę zachwiania bezpieczeństwa żywnościowego w Europie. Dziękuję bardzo.
Thank you so much. The floor goes to colleague Radim Sen for 1 minute.
On behalf of EPP and as a chair of Rural Pact Coordination Group and a proud rural citizen, I would like to thank very much for the huge support of all members of European Parliament and the groups for rural development. We are very closely cooperating with Isabel and also with Frank Bogovic in our group. Unfortunately, the actions are not reflecting our discussion so far. Even, for example, the proposal for e-marking in cohesion policy for rural areas have not passed in the European Parliament. So I hope that in the future those proposals will pass. Because as we see in the geography of discontent, we are not reaching the people in the rural areas in a good way. And we need to do much more to bring the long-term vision for rural areas from the sky of Brussels Ivory Tower to the people. We need for that to really make a holistic, integrated and multi-fund approach. We need to invest in the quality of life in the rural areas, and we need to build up a rural pride. And we need to communicate it much better to people. We need to sit with them to explain by simple words what the Europe is bringing, to have a beer in the Czech Republic or Austria or Ireland, or to have a wine in France or Italy. And we have to communicate it. Please do that before the European elections, because then we can switch off the lights in the rural areas.
Thank you. Now the floor goes to Isilda Gomes for 2 minutes.
Obrigada, Presidente. Senhoras e senhores deputados, caros colegas, o nono relatório sobre a coesão sublinha que as zonas rurais enfrentam desafios específicos que dificultam o crescimento económico e o desenvolvimento. No entanto, no período 2001-2021, as regiões não urbanas registaram um crescimento do PIB per capita significativamente mais elevado do que as regiões urbanas, 1,5% contra 0,8%, de acordo com o relatório sobre a coesão. Por esta razão, pensamos que a estratégia a longo prazo para as zonas rurais não pode continuar a ser uma declaração de intenções. Tem de ser um plano de ação europeu claro, com o orçamento atribuído, objetivos quantitativos e uma aplicação efetiva em todas as políticas da União Europeia. De facto, muitas regiões rurais e menos desenvolvidas têm um elevado potencial, por exemplo, para produzir energia renovável ou para a captura e armazenamento de carbono em ecossistemas naturais. temos de desenvolver as políticas e o financiamento que libertem este potencial rural. Isso significa que precisamos de uma política de coesão que concentre mais a sua atenção nos desafios das zonas rurais, mas também de uma política agrícola comum renovada. Com efeito, considero que a crise rural e agrícola europeia não pode ser resolvida de forma sustentável se não reduzirmos drasticamente as desigualdades sociais e as injustiças gritantes no âmbito do modelo económico agrícola. Propomos, por isso, reequilibrar os pagamentos diretos da PAC, impondo pagamentos redistributivos favoráveis às pequenas e médias explorações e limitando os pagamentos às explorações de maior dimensão. Queremos também mais fundos para as regiões, a fim de melhorar o desenvolvimento rural no âmbito do segundo pilar da PAC, regionalização da PAC. Temos de pôr fim ao atual status quo agrícola.
Thank you so much. The floor goes to Emiliano Sanchez, 2 minutes.
Muchísimas gracias, señor presidente. Un día como hoy, en el año 55, fallecía Albert Einstein, que entre otras muchas cosas dejó una frase para la historia. Más importante y más fuerte que el vapor, que la electricidad y que la energía atómica es la voluntad humana. Y hoy quiero expresar aquí lo que me gustaría fuera, en la próxima etapa que viene de las elecciones, la Unión Europea, para asentar con mucha voluntad 3 premisas. Una, los agricultores, el sector del campo, no son culpables del cambio climático. Son más víctimas y en potencia las víctimas mayores del cambio climático. En segundo lugar, nadie puede negar el cambio climático. Apoyamos el concepto de transición, pero en su justa literalidad. Transición evoca aplicación con ritmo progresivo de las decisiones. Y muchos hoy en Europa ven que los ritmos son más propios de una revolución que de una transición. Y en tercer lugar, que para completar y entender bien el concepto de sostenibilidad ambiental tiene que enmarcarse en el concepto también de sostenibilidad económica, sostenibilidad social y sostenibilidad cultural. Ese es el concepto auténtico que nos llevaría a practicar políticas coherentes. Y sobre esa base planteamos sobre todo que el pilar 1 de la política agraria comunitaria se refuerce para aceptar en él la inclusión del objetivo del 25% de la superficie dedicada a políticas ecológicas, a producción ecológica. Y que eso, junto con las cláusulas espejo frente a importaciones indebidas, permitan al sector del campo competir en mejores condiciones. Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you. Member Cecile Gallien, you have the floor for 3 minutes.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. L'espace rural européen représente 80% de l'espace. Qui le dit? Qui le sait? Un tiers de la population européenne vit sur ces espaces ruraux. J'avais eu l'opportunité de travailler sur l'agenda rural français, puisque c'était un souhait de la Commission européenne. On parlait de la Convention de Cork. Cet espace est stratégique pour l'Union européenne, stratégique pour la souveraineté alimentaire et agricole, on en a déjà parlé, stratégique aussi parce qu'il ne faut pas laisser les ruraux en dehors de l'égalité des droits, puisque tout Européen doit avoir une égalité pour avoir une éducation de qualité, une formation de qualité. Le numérique a progressé au cœur de nos territoires ruraux, avec la téléphonie mobile, avec le haut débit, mais nous n'avons pas encore était jusqu'au dernier kilomètre. Il faut y aller, c'est essentiel. La mobilité est un droit aussi pour tous les Européens, y compris ruraux. Or, nous n'avons pas beaucoup de transports collectifs dans nos territoires ruraux. Parfois, nous avons des lignes de train qu'il faut absolument sauvegarder, qu'on peut mettre en connexion avec le bus scolaire, avec le covoiturage, dont les jeunes sont absolument friands et débrouillards. Le Les territoires ruraux, c'est pouvoir habiter, choisir d'habiter dans nos territoires. Or, il y a des territoires ruraux qui sont attractifs. Des gens des villes veulent partir des villes et habiter dans nos territoires. Nous n'avons pas la possibilité, parfois pas les moyens financiers, de rénover, de créer des logements et puis aussi d'aller vers l'isolation thermique pour contraindre le froid et le chaud que nous subissons au cœur de nos territoires ruraux. Qui sait qu'en France, 27% de l'emploi industriel est dans les territoires ruraux? Quel est ce chiffre de l'emploi industriel au cœur de nos territoires ruraux européens? Il est important. Les territoires ruraux, c'est des ressources, c'est des gisements, c'est des savoir-faire, c'est aussi de l'innovation. Habiter en territoire rural, c'est aussi avoir le droit de vieillir, c'est-à-dire avoir des services de santé, des maisons de retraite associatives parfois qui ont des problèmes d'équilibre financier parce que les retraites parfois des habitants ruraux sont faibles. Il faut aussi une Europe solidaire par rapport à ceci. Et qui dit espace dit aussi création d'énergie renouvelable. Nous le souhaitons tous. L'hydroélectricité, le photovoltaïque, la forêt, on en a déjà parlé. Les puits de carbone, ce sont les forêts, ce sont les prairies. Et tout ça, c'est sur l'ensemble des territoires ruraux. Donc, des maires, des acteurs locaux, de communes rurales, de secteurs ruraux se battent au quotidien pour maintenir la dynamique de ces territoires ruraux. Si nous voulons une Europe forte et fraternelle, et nous le souhaitons tous, il faut qu'on mette un peu plus de moyens financiers et une réelle politique de cohésion européenne en faveur de ces 80% d'espace que sont les territoires ruraux européens. Merci à tous.
Thank you. The floor goes to member Adam Banask. You have the floor, sir. You have the floor for 2.5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, distinguished guests, dear COR members. One of the biggest challenges for the future European Union Parliament will be defending our rural areas. Frustration taking our farmers to the streets. There is a clear message to European Union lawmakers. Let the farmers breathe a bit. There is a spiral of standards, bans and constraints that is impossible for agricultural producers to keep up with. The European Green Deal has slowed down the European Union's industrial output and put us at a huge disadvantage compared to other continents. We have more red tape, more regulations, but higher targets and no coherent industrial policy to back it up. Some European leaders are calling for a break from new green legislation. There has been such an increase in legislative activity on climate standards during this mandate that did not seem to take into account the impact on agriculture and on industrial competitiveness. On top of the regulations, the European Union farming sector is facing an increasing demographic challenge, the shortage of young farmers. We need to empower our rural areas. They are key for food security and natural resources. Our farmers represent and provide a large share of rural jobs and are an important economic contribution to the national fabric. But our rural areas are in decline. A lack of public services, brain drain, economic opportunities, demographic decline are just some of the major challenges our rural citizens are dealing with. Those living in rural areas feel completely disconnected from the elites in Brussels. We should protect our countryside and make them places that offer people the opportunity and choice to be able to live in the communities in which they grew up. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Now the floor goes to Member Krzysztof Iwaniuk. You have the floor for 2 minutes.
Dziękuję bardzo. Obszary wiejskie rzeczywiście są w coraz trudniejszej sytuacji, ponieważ no, pamiętajmy, że co czwarta osoba w Unii Europejskiej mieszka na wsi. I to jest 80% przestrzeni. W moim kraju jest to jeszcze więcej, bo 40% populacji Polaków mieszka w obszarach wiejskich. No i jest to 93% powierzchni kraju. I teraz polityka spójności, wspólna polityka rolna praktycznie koncentrowała się na rolnikach. I jednak te ciągniki wyjechały na ulice europejskich miast. Natomiast nawet w najbardziej rolniczych regionach Francji, Unii, czy najbardziej rolniczych regionach też ilość żyjących wyłącznie z rolnictwa czy związanych z rolnictwem jest poniżej 10%, co najwyżej. Także wieś to nie tylko rolnictwo. I tam się, tak jak wszyscy przedmówcy mówili, koncentrują wszystkie problemy gospodarcze, społeczne, służby zdrowia, edukacji i tak dalej. Dysproporcje się pogłębiają. Jeżeli nie odwrócimy tych trendów, to za następnych 20 lat będzie jeszcze większy problem, bo z krajobrazów europejskich zniknie prawie 30 milionów ludzi. To jest tyle, co wspólnie Rumunia, Bułgaria i Litwa razem wzięte. I teraz, jeżeli popatrzymy, że jeżeli nie będziemy przeciwdziałać pogłębianiu dysproporcji, no to tam nikt nie będzie chciał wrócić. Będą potrzebne programy zaludniania niektórych regionów, praktycznie każdych regionów, szczególnie tych w tych obszarach oddalonych od dużych metropolii. To będą dużo droższe programy. Dlatego potrzebny, w moim przekonaniu, jest specjalny program do obszarów wiejskich oddalonych, który by zaczął przeciwdziałać tym zjawiskom, które są bardzo niepokojące, a szczególnie też i ta sprawa starzenia się. Jeżeli nie chcemy, żeby tam rosły frustracje antyunijne, co przed wyborami jest niezwykle ważne, żeby wyznawały nasze wartości, te władze lokalne i regionalne same nie dadzą rady, bo tam jest dziedziczenie biedy od wielu lat. Dziękuję.
Thank you so much. And now, on behalf of the Greens, we have Erika von Kalpen. You have the floor for 2 minutes.
Ja, Herr Präsident, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, zuerst möchte ich mal betonen, dass der Green Deal nicht den ländlichen Raum gefährdet und auch nicht die Zukunft der Landwirtschaft gefährdet. Da bin ich ganz anderer Meinung als meine Vorredner, sondern im Gegenteil, der Green Deal kann gerade auch die Chance sein, die ländlichen Räume zu schützen vor noch mehr Dürre, vor Bränden, vor Überschwemmungen. Dass wir hier den ländlichen Raum in dieser Abschlussdebatte vor der Wahl in den Blick nehmen, finde ich sehr wichtig, weil er ist für uns existenziell und zwar auch für unsere Demokratie. Wir sehen ja, dass immer mehr Menschen sich in Europa nicht gesehen fühlen. Es wurde schon genannt, die Proteste der Landwirte, auch in meinem Land gehen sie auf die Straße. Und deswegen braucht es auch weiterhin gute strukturelle Förderung, die wirklich den Menschen in den ländlichen Räumen hilft. Ich danke Frau Gomez sehr für Ihre Hinweise und auch für die Diskussion, die wir zu den Agrarmitteln im Nature dazu hatten. Und, meine Damen und Herren, ich glaube, es ist nicht nur eine Frage von Geld, sondern was wir beobachten bei uns, ist eine Frage der Fachkräfte. Gerade der Bereich der Gesundheit und der Pflege, der kann ja nicht nur durch Geld gelöst werden, sondern dadurch, dass Menschen in den Regionen leben und arbeiten wollen. Das Gleiche gilt auch für den Tourismus, weil natürlich viele ländliche Regionen auch Tourismusregionen sind und die können nur dann wirtschaften, wenn dort auch Menschen leben und wohnen können. Abschließend möchte ich noch einmal betonen, dass wir hier ja wirklich gute Debatten zur Kohäsionspolitik gehabt haben. Und ich bin sehr dankbar dafür, dass hier im Ausschuss der Region überwiegend zumindest noch eine sehr große Mehrheit der Meinung ist, dass wir sie weiterführen müssen. Vielen Dank.
Thank you. Now interventions from the floor. Marco Vesligas, you have the floor for 1 minute.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll speak on Croatian. Ako nam je stalo i ako brinemo o svakom stanovniku, o svakom području Europske unije, onda bi nam ruralna područja koja su prožeta i manjim urbanim središtima trebala biti jako važna. Jer ravnomjerni razvoj cijele Europske unije je ključan. A naša ruralna područja često su zakinuta kada je riječ o infrastrukturi i dostupnosti osnovnih usluga. Veliki izazov s kojim se suočavamo je svakako javni prijevoz. U ruralnim područjima Hrvatske nedostatak efikasnog javnog prijevoza znatno otežava pristup obrazovanju, zdravstvenoj skrbi i tržištu rada i to onda direktno utječe na životne šanse stanovnika tih područja. Drugo je stanovanje. Nedostatak priuštivih mogućnosti za rješavanje stambenog pitanja tjera mlade obitelji da napuštaju te regije. Moramo investirati u stambenu infrastrukturu kako bismo zadržali i provukli stanovništvo. Kohezijska politika mora ponuditi rješenja kroz financiranje projekata koji mogu direktno poboljšati ovu situaciju. Trebamo i podršku lokalnim inicijativama koje unapređuju obrazovanje, zdravstvo, ali potiču i male poduzetnike da bi oživjeli naša ruralna područja. Zaključit ću da suradnja svih razina vlasti u korištenju sredstava kohezijske politike može znatno promijeniti stvarnost ruralnih područja, stvarajući od njih udana mjesta za život.
Thank you. Member Herranz Garcia, you have the floor for 1 minute. Member Yuri Gottmans, you have the floor for 1 minute.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll continue in Estonian language. Väga palju maapiirkondade asjus on juba räägitud ja õiged punktid välja toodud, kuid rääkimata on olnud julgeoleku aspekt. Nimelt meil Eestis ja ka paljudes teistes riikides maapiirkonnad piirnevad ka riigi piiriga, Euroopa Liidu piiriga. Ja väga tähtis on, et maapiirkonnad säiliks, et seal oleks elu ja see oleks abiks ka meie julgeolekustruktuuridele piirivalvele. Seega aastatuhanded on inimesed otsinud abi maa piirkondades sõdade, katkude ja muul aegadel. Arvan, et linna piirkonnad peaksid olema solidaarsed maa piirkondadega ja toetama ka edaspidi arengut maa piirkondades. Aitäh!
Thank you. I don't have any other requests for the floor. No, I don't have any other requests for the floor. We will have final remarks from our guest speakers, and we will start with Cole Markey. 3 minutes.
Thank you very much. It's very interesting to hear all the perspectives. I think if we look at it, the most important asset we have in our rural areas is people. And how we invest in people living and working in rural areas is critical. I think one of the problems we've had, particularly for the opportunities for people in rural areas, is, if you like, there isn't enough economic generation and therefore people move elsewhere. I think we have to look at what are the key multipliers that we can have in rural areas that will create more opportunities. Obviously, we mentioned agriculture traditionally, and I think the speaker that spoke after me made the point that, if you like, there are others, and that's why I think we equally need to look at rural development in the context of access to digital services, access to broadband, and to ensure that these services are available. Equally, we have to have the social services available that give people the same opportunity, both socially as much as economically in those rural areas. And that has been a problem in terms of the level of investment. And I think most people have highlighted that here today. The other probably key point in relation to it is the idea of a bottoms-up approach, be it through well-recognised, through leader and through local authorities, that ultimately, if you give a little bit of local autonomy to take advantage of the opportunities that they are both socially and economically, that local government and the like of leader investment in those local areas is the way in which we can most effectively, if you like, invest to take advantage of the opportunities, whether it be the renewable energies opportunities, whether it's the concept of remote working and bringing outside investment in. Ultimately, as I said at the start, if we have the idea of being able to invest economically in the area, then that will bring more energy, more young people, more involvement into our areas. And that economic driver will drive the social economy too. And if the problem we're facing, if we don't address that, is the isolation issues. Older people were mentioned earlier. If young people have to move away and then the older generation are left isolated with no holistic family care around them, that leads to the decline of our rural areas as well. So it has to be an integrated, holistic approach, multi-generational approach, where young families are there with an older generation to protect or to support. When people go off to work, the grandparents are there to collect the children. When, if you like, the older people are in need of care, the next generation are there with them. And that fabric of rural communities has been lost. Investment in new opportunities, investment in social infrastructure are critical to rebuilding that fabric in rural areas. And I think that is critical in terms of the future of our rural areas, that we get the economic opportunities, but equally we invest in the infrastructure that allow people to have a quality of life equivalent to what they have in urban areas.
Thank you. Isabel Carvalhais, 3 minutes.
Thank you so much. I will just make 3 brief remarks. First, we have to insist that rural world doesn't have to justify its existence. It doesn't have to justify its dignity and its value on the basis of all the benefits that it brings to the urban world. We have to tell this to people, because most of the time it seems that we're trying to justify the existence of the rural world because it brings food security, because of biodiversity and all the other benefits. The rural world has its own dignity and it has the right to exist. And the second remark I would like to do is that we do need a European rural strategy. And this implies resources, all sorts of resources, financial resources. So we have to fight also against the idea that the CAP has too much money. What it needs, and I fully agree and subscribe what Isilda Gomes said, it needs to be better distributed. And finally, I was also rapporteur for the dossier on the generational renewal in agriculture. And please, let's listen to what young farmers were saying to us. They complain a lot about isolation and mental health issues, connectivity, mobility. They complain about the lack of offers of in terms of culture, of leisure, education, and etc. But one of the biggest complaints has to do with the access to land. So let's be very clear and ask, what is happening to our rural landscapes? Who is buying our arable lands? With what purposes? We need an observatory of land. Usually we used to talk about land grabbing when we were talking about African countries, for instance. And it's unbelievable that we may have grabbing issues and obviously concentration of land issues in Europe. And land is essential if we want young farmers to keep going on. Of course, agriculture is not the sole activity of rural economy, but it's the backbone of our rural areas. And without young farmers, without young generations, it will be impossible to go on having a rural world full of life as we all wish for the future. That's the remarks I would like to do. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And now the floor goes to MEP Siolos for 3 minutes.
Thank you. First remark, we didn't talk too much about peripheral regions to the border of European Union. We are preparing a new enlargement process, and the representative of the regions, you also play a key role to reinforce the cooperation between rural areas around the surrounding European Union, and I think we have to integrate this in our policies. Some of you told about the need to have an integrated vision about rural areas, and I think this can come from your side, and this can help us in European Union, but also in European Commission, because we need this integrated vision, but unfortunately, both in the Parliament and in the Commission, we still are the, this approach of a silos approach. Each sector analyzes it one by one in terms of policy, but in terms of budget also. We will discuss in the next 2 years about the cohesion policy, agriculture and rural development policy, and about the budget. And I think it's a key moment to discuss about financial resources to finance the development of rural areas, and how to combine different public financial sources, and as I mentioned at the beginning, to integrate also private sector. We didn't talk too much about the role of the youngs in rural areas, because I think if rural areas will be attractive, we will attract more young. And generational renewable, it's a problem in agriculture, and we have to ensure public services for the youngs, generally speaking, in rural area, but also speaking about young farmers to ensure their dignity, their professional dignity, which means to discuss also about how we will ensure the income of farmers when we talk about food security, when we talk about good management of natural resources. We have the young people wanted to come in rural area, and what is interesting, people born in urban area interested to have a better quality of life, and they are attracted by rural area, and I think we have to use the opportunity of this flow to rebalance development between rural and urban area. But again, this is about clarity in our legislation and financial resources. Thank you.
Thank you so much. The floor goes to Member Galigani for 3 minutes.
Grazie ancora, Presidente. Dunque, in conclusione, io penso che noi dobbiamo smettere di lanciare messaggi contraddittori. Per parlare di provvedimenti di cui abbiamo trattato in quest'aula, per esempio con la legge sulla rinaturalizzazione, se noi trattiamo i territori, le aree rurali, le aree coltivate, come se fossero delle aree da recuperare, da rinaturalizzare, noi che messaggio stiamo dando ai nostri cittadini, ai nostri agricoltori? Noi stiamo dando il messaggio che loro sono il problema, al quale dobbiamo trovare una soluzione. Se noi continuiamo a infliggere agli agricoltori una sequela interminabile di standard a cui conformarsi e di burocrazia da espletare, che messaggio stiamo dando? Come possiamo garantire, ne parlava prima il mio collega, il passaggio generazionale? Il mestiere dell'agricoltore sarà percepito come poco attrattivo e quindi non si realizzerà il passaggio generazionale. Due elementi. Numero uno, dobbiamo smettere di considerare le zone rurali come un problema, come aree esclusivamente depresse da compatire. Le zone rurali sono una ricchezza da sfruttare, numero uno. Numero due, anche vista la questione geopolitica, l'attuale tempera geopolitica, la sovranità alimentare non è più un'opportunità, è un imperativo a cui dobbiamo conformarci. Per concludere, abbiamo gli elementi che sono emersi da questa discussione. Numero uno, che dobbiamo sostenere i servizi sul territorio, perché altrimenti le persone abbandoneranno territori rurali. Numero due, connettività e digitalizzazione. Numero tre, infrastrutture. Numero 4, abbattere la burocrazia. Numero 5, non ne abbiamo parlato, un elemento che mi piacerebbe introdurre, ridurre il delta che divide il prezzo pagato all'agricoltore da quello pagato dal consumatore in negozio. Un ulteriore elemento di cui non abbiamo parlato, la concorrenza esterna sleale, che è un qualcosa che è particolarmente odioso per gli agricoltori. In ultima istanza, se noi vogliamo che l'Unione Europea recuperi credibilità e recuperi visibilità fra agricoltori e popolarità, noi dobbiamo lasciarli lavorare e dobbiamo far sì che le politiche europee per loro siano un'opportunità, e per fare questo noi dobbiamo cominciare noi stessi a considerare le aree rurali come un'opportunità da sfruttare e non come un problema da risolvere. Grazie.
Thank you so much, Member Galigani. We know you have time constraints. Thank you so much for being with us today in this debate. Now the floor goes to MEP Massard. You have the floor for 3 minutes.
Merci. Alors, j'ai entendu pendant les débats que les zones rurales doivent faire preuve de créativité. Alors, moi qui vis en zone rurale depuis 45 ans, je dois vous dire que la créativité, je la vis tous les jours et je crois que les habitants des zones rurales sont encore plus créatifs que les autres. Moi, je crois que les zones rurales, aujourd'hui, elles ont besoin de démocratie. Elles ont besoin de démocratie parce que, par exemple, chez moi, en Bretagne, quand un Breton ou une Bretonne reçoit 3 euros de subvention pour la culture, eh bien, un Parisien en reçoit plus de 35. Et c'est là la différence entre les zones rurales et entre les territoires et entre les grandes métropoles. Il est temps de rééquilibrer un petit peu les choses. Et je crois que l'Union européenne avait jusque-là été un peu ce trait d'union et que, effectivement, on sent moins aujourd'hui cette aide et on sent moins cette, ce couple entre les régions et l'Union européenne. Et puis, je voudrais dire aussi que si on veut que les choses s'améliorent dans les zones rurales, eh bien, il va bien falloir un jour tenir compte de ce que pensent les décideurs locaux. Moi, je ne comprends pas, par exemple, que le président de ma région, quoi qu'on pense des pesticides de synthèse, mais en tout cas, lui, il a proposé d'être, de sortir et d'être terre d'expérimentation des pesticides de synthèse en Bretagne. Eh bien, aujourd'hui, c'est une voix qui n'est absolument pas entendue dans l'Union européenne, alors que ma région, la Bretagne, est une des plus grandes régions agricoles de l'Union européenne. Et je crois qu'aujourd'hui, si on veut réussir les choses, si on veut que les zones rurales se développent, eh bien, il faut tenir compte des pouvoirs locaux et des décideurs et des collectivités locales, parce qu'eux connaissent leur territoire, ils en connaissent les atouts, ils en connaissent les limites, ils en connaissent les contraintes, ils connaissent les gens, ils connaissent la culture, ils connaissent la langue, et ils savent prendre des décisions qui sont bien plus appropriées que des décisions qui sont parfois prises loin des individus et loin des territoires. Alors moi, je terminerai en disant qu'on a beaucoup aussi entendu aujourd'hui vivre et travailler au pays. Alors effectivement, c'est le rêve de beaucoup de gens qui habitent les territoires ruraux et qui aujourd'hui ne le peuvent pas parce qu'ils sont contraints de partir. Mais moi, je dirais vivre, travailler, décider au pays, décider avec les décideurs locaux.
Thank you. The floor goes to Member Hattilainen. 3 minutes.
Kiitos puheenjohtaja. Minusta on selvää, että kaikki yritykset vesittää vihreän kehityksen ohjelmaa ja sen rahoitus on maaseutualueiden pärjäämistä vastaan. Jos tästä rahoituksesta leikattaisiin selvästi alueiden mahdollisuuksista rahoittaa kestäviä investointeja. Itse asiassa tämä olisi aika vakavasti Kiinan pussiin pelaamista, sillä heillä kyllä riittää valtion tukea vihreää teknologiaa. Reilu siirtymä on kaikkein paras ratkaisu syrjäseutujen pärjäämiselle. Keskustelussa tuli ilmi myös inklusiivisuus monessa puheenvuorossa ja eri ihmisryhmien tarpeet. Oikeastaan feministinen aluepolitiikka auttaisi meitä tässä tehtävässä. Se ottaisi huomioon ihmisten tarpeet, sellaisten ihmisten, jotka ovat hauraassa asemassa tai kärsivät päällekkäisistä tekijöistä, jotka eriarvoistavat heitä. Feministinen aluepolitiikka jatkossa olisi konsepti, joka antaisi meille mahdollisuuden esimerkiksi löytää vastauksia siihen, miten voimme tukea syrjäseuduilla asuvia, matalasti koulutettuja ja osattomuutta kokevia nuoria miehiä? Tämä on yksi asia, mihin kannattaisi puuttua Euroopassa. Ruoan hinta on tällä hetkellä historiallisen korkealla, mutta viljelijöiden saamat tulot ovat historiallisen matalalla verrattuna elinkustannusindekseihin. Nykyinen maatalouspolitiikka on tässä selvästi epäonnistunut ja luulen, että haluamme kaikki uudistaa maatalouspolitiikkaa sellaiseksi, joka tukee ihmistä ja planeetan hyvinvointia. Keskustelussa sivuttiin myös turvallisuutta, ja se on kovin hyvä, koska tahtoisin lopuksi lisätä vielä omilla kokemuksillani Suomesta, että asuttu raja on kaikkein turvallisin raja. Tämä fakta tässä ajassa kasvattaa mielestäni entisestään aluepolitiikan merkitystä. Olin itse muutama päivä sitten tilaisuudessa, jossa käsiteltiin aluepolitiikkaa Suomessa, ja eräs harvaan asutulla alueella asuva nainen halusi pitää yhden puheenvuoron, mikä jäi erityisesti mieleeni. Hän oli pahastunut siitä, että alueita ja syrjäseutuja puhutaan usein negatiivisen kierteen ja ongelmien kautta. Hän viihtyy hyvin kotiseudullaan, siellä on puhdasta ilmaa, tilaa, perheille hyviä palveluita, vehreyttä ja hän kokee siellä hyvinvointia ja mahdollisuuksia kasvattaa yritystoimintaansa. Tämä jäi itselleni mieleen siitä, että meidän täytyy tehdä myös sen eteen töitä, että käymme ratkaisukeskeistä keskustelua alueiden tilanteesta ja näemme myös alueiden vahvuudet verrattuna kaupunkialueisiin, koska niitä on myös paljon ja kaikkia alueita pitää tukea niiden omista lähtökohdista. Täällä keskustelussa on hyvin tullut ilmi, että alueet eivät ole samanlaisia, kaikilla on omat ominaispiirteet, haasteet ja vahvuudet ja siinähän se ydin onkin, että tuemme jokaista aluetta ja annamme alueelle mahdollisuuksia kehittyä omista lähtökohdistaan. Kiitos.
Thank you so much. This concludes this point of our agenda. I would like on behalf of the Committee of the Regions to thank you once more to all the guest speakers here today. Thank you for your time and for sharing with us our views. Thank you. Now we're going to move to point 24. It's election of bureau members. We are requested to approve the nominations of new members of the bureau, as mentioned in the document that was published in the members' portal. If there are no comments, the nominations are approved. Point 25. For your information, you have in the members' portal the list of new COR members and alternates. I welcome all of them to our assembly. Point 26, any other business? I would like, on behalf of the Committee of the Regions, to thank Greens Group co-president Una Power and everyone associated with her for this is her last plenary. I think I speak for everybody to wish her the best in the future. Also to thank member Kate Feeney for her participation and for her commitment in our assembly. And is not, thank you so much, and I wish you all the best in the future. Is not here with us, he had to leave, but Orio Darius Strugala, this was his last plenary. So thank him and also wish him all the best in the future.
Yes, of course.
I'll now give the floor to our first vice president, Apostolos Tsitsikostas.
Well, I would like to say a very big thanks to Ms. Power, of course, and Ms. Feeney. And allow me 1 minute, Mr. President, because I worked very closely during my presidency and after with Kate Feeney, to say that it is a big loss for our House to see Member Feeney leaving today the Committee of the Regions. And I certainly hope that the time will soon come that she will be back with us. We have a lot of great things to do together, and we are looking forward in continuing this great collaboration with you. Kate Feeney has worked endlessly all these years with dedication to our efforts and our goals, and has succeeded in many tasks. So I personally thank her a lot for this great collaboration, and I wish her, along with our other colleague who's leaving today, all the best to Ms. Power as well and her beautiful baby today. Thank you very much, both of you.
Dear colleagues, the date, point 27, the date of our next meeting is on June 19 and 20 of June in Brussels. I would like to thank you all for your presence here. I would like to thank the staff, the secretariat, the technicians, the interpreters. Also a big thank to them for their work. And I would like to wish you all a good return to your regions and to your cities. The session is concluded 1 minute ahead of schedule. Thank you so much. Thank you, Apostolos.
President.
The best.
Secretary General.